Yeah, Sony Ray. 1-2, 1-2. Honey, baby.
Here for your can't even walk a mile in my shoes. Every day I'm up before the sun. What snooze? Wonder Woman in the flesh? Baby, I'm superhuman. Been beat all the way down. I'm stronger from the bruises. If I don't keep myself up, everything will fall down. I'm just trying to make a dollar from that lit up in the couch. Hit them where it counts till it hit my account. Your love will motivate me. I can never let you down. Pen in the concrete till my feet bleed. Pressure's always on. Never feel relief. Never feel complete. Always want more. Coming for everything. And I ain't scared.
I'm gonna slut. Mommy, get the bag popping all on my own. I do what I want. Yeah, I'm just a queen popping all on my own.
Your boy Blue, the Bill Luciano, and I'm here with
Tora Shabazz,
and of course our first female artist. Woo! On YTFM. We have the marvelous Honey. Hey. Hey, so we're blessed to have our second artist on YTFM radio. Thank you very much for y'all support, and please support our artists. Let's put CT on the map.
On the map.
Let's go.
Hey, honey, where you from?
New Britain.
New Britain. Shout not New Britain, Britain. Ave. New Britain.
New Britain, Connecticut, baby. Shout out.
Shout out, shout out, shout out.
So, honey, tell the world, what made you start getting involved in music? Where did it all start?
All right. So, I started rapping because, you know, for people of my generation, BET used to play videos all day.
What?
So,
what?
BET?
So, there was this one summer that Lil' Kim came out with a song called the Knox and Night Remix.
Okay.
So, I'm sitting in my grandmother's kitchen, BET is playing, and I saw the video and I thought it was super cool. I thought, I was like, man, they're having like the most fun because that video is fire. If you've never seen that video, please go on YouTube and look up Lil' Kim, Not Tonight Remix. You won't be disappointed. But yeah, when I saw that video, I was like, man, that's cool. I want to do that. And I grabbed a notebook, paper, and started writing.
So seeing that it was Lil' Kim that kind of influenced you, you think you influenced a lot of female growing up?
That's what my goal is. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I haven't had anybody younger, I would say, reach out to me yet.
Okay.
I haven't really come across a lot of young females.
Right.
I've come across like young males, you know what I mean? And I've actually had a couple young males tell me that I've inspired them musically.
That's dope.
Yo, I'm gonna tell you why. When I listen to your track, it's like you're knocking somebody out. Like, you aggressive.
You're a beast. Like, you're a beast.
She's timid right now, yo. Don't let this fool you, bro.
Please don't let it fool you.
For real. Yo, wait till she get on the track. Yo, listen to her music. She got a big-ass bite.
Yes, she does. And watch out.
I be chilling. You know, like, I'm a chill individual. But, you know, once I'm on the mic or I'm on stage or, you know, whatever, that's Honey. And Honey is like, you know, I get over there and it's like, yeah, I'm that bitch and I'm here. And, you know, that's how you gotta be.
That's fact, like, man. You gotta be. I don't care who you are. If you feel you're a rapper and you just started yesterday and you say you're the greatest rapper of all time, believe it. Keep believing it.
You gotta have faith in yourself.
You gotta look at Lil Wayne. Lil Wayne is the self-proclaimed. Best rapper alive. He willed himself into being known as the best rapper alive.
That's so true.
People don't realize how powerful those words are.
That's so true.
I'm not sure if I know, but I think you're like the first female rap artist in Connecticut for me.
Really?
Yes, really. I mean,
well, that's dope.
It is. That's why when I heard him play some music, I was like, yo, who's this? Yo, she nice. Like, I couldn't capture who you were, like, without seeing the video, without knowing your name. I'm trying to put you in a in a hip hop category. Like, what female is this in hip hop? Mm-hmm. And I said, I can't get it. And then I asked, and he was like, honey. I was like, honey. I'm like, I don't know who she is, but she's fire. She's fire.
Dope.
That's dope.
The crazy thing about it, too, you know, I've known Honey for some time. We went to school together. And she always had that same mentality when it comes to music. It was just an animal, a beast. Like, when she spits her rhyme, she believes in it. You can tell by her voice. You can hear it in her sound. So I'm so proud of you.
Yeah, you got like a little raspiness to your voice. I like that. That's like that's why I'm telling you. It's like you're like the female DMX. Let's scratch out Eve right quick. No disrespect. You understand? Like your raspiness is what gives you that persona. I like that.
You know what's real funny is like my project where like Got a Stunt and Trending and all of that is from. We recorded two projects actually down in Atlanta. And when I was out there, we worked with Pierre Medora, who's originally from New Haven area.
New Haven, shout
and,
out.
But he's been out in Atlanta for a long time now. So we went out there to record, and that was a new experience for me because P is like, you know, this is a Grammy award winning producer, and he's worked with so many amazing people in the industry. And here he is working with little old me on my project. And you know, the way he had me in that studio, I'm sitting there like, bruh, I'm tired. Like, I'm used to, you know, being out here where I do 2-3 takes and they be like, yeah, that sound fire. Pierre's like, nah, 15 times every hook, 15 times every verse. That's so, you know, it's like by the time you get to 15, I'm like, raw. I'm tired. Yeah. I'm like, but that's what P was trying to bring up with me. He's like, no, Nikki, that's it right there. Right. Like, that sound. So all these verses that you like that sound and stuff, that's like take 15.
So let me ask you a question. You still use that same method in recording now?
I've learned how to get to take 15 faster. You know what I mean? Because, you know, that's what it is. It's like you have to learn and grow from each experience. So that experience, I was thrown into a situation that I had never been in. Right. So it was literally like, yo, we're booking a flight. You're going to Atlanta for 4 days, and 3 out of those 4 days, you're locked into the studio recording. Mm, nice. So it was like, you know, all day sessions. It wasn't going to the studio for 2 hours and then waiting until I get my track mixed and, you know, whatever. It was literally like, yo, no, we're here all day and we're making a whole album. Like, you're not leaving. You're locking in. We'll get some food and that's about it, you know?
So you were in a bubble way before the bubble came
out. Yes. So, you know, we in there, we doing all that, but I learned. You know, that was a learning process for me. So now when I'm here and I'm working with other engineers, I'm thinking about Pierre. Like, so I'm thinking like, what would Pierre tell me in my head? You know what I'm saying? Because he really stuck to me, you know? And we have a great friendship now still. Like, you know, I can text him whenever. And I'm actually trying to head down to Atlanta again soon because there was a song that we didn't do last time that is like stuck in my head that I'm like, I need to do this song with him.
You got the name to it?
Yeah, it's a song dedicated to my grandmother who passed. He actually named it Carmen's Song. So that's always stuck in my head. And it's like, it's 2 years later now since we had that discussion and we never worked on that song just because of like where the project ended up taking us. So now I'm like, for my next project that I'm working on now, I'm like, Carmen's Song, it has to be there, and P has to be the one to do it.
Please, I would like to listen to that.
With that being said, working with different artists, obviously, Pierre, you consider yourself a perfectionist now when it comes to making a track? Are you hard on yourself? What mentality do you have when you make that music?
I've always been hard on myself. Like, I've wasted a lot of money in the studio, like, going back in and re-recording a record. I actually got one record that I brought. What is it? It's called Mommy Loves You. And that one, I think we did 7 different takes to it. Mm-hmm. 7 different takes, 2 different people on the hook. Like, I took one person off, put another person on. Like, you know, and because I was on that level of like, no, it has to be a certain way. And then even like, you know, my husband or people would be like, yo, this sounds fire. And I'd be like, it's missing something. So for me, I'm always like super hard on myself. And I could even, everybody in a whole room could be like, yo, honey, it's fire, it's perfect. Mm-hmm. And it could be playing on the radio. And I'll still be like,
You can hear what's not right.
I should have just added this one ad lib, and people be looking at me like, "Oh, you're bugging," and I'm like, "No, I'm telling you that one ad lib would have like set it off, you know." It's but I think all artists go into that, and I think all artists should be like that, because if you're just so satisfied with the shit you do, you just gonna be willing to put out anything. Right, right. You know what I mean?
So adding to that, to Torsha Bass question. Do you work better with people in the room or without people in the room?
It depends on who the people are, because I don't like just having people hanging out in my sessions. If you're in my session, it's because you are another creative and I value your opinion. There's other creatives that people, you know, a lot of people are creatives these days. Let's keep it real. Everybody's a fucking rapper or whatever. You know, everybody throws some auto-tune on their shit and their singer or whatever. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's not, they're taking the art out of artists. You know what I'm saying? So I don't want everybody in my session. I want people of value in my session. So if I feel like you're not of value, I'm going to tell the engineer, like, yo, can you tell your people they got to go or whatever. But like recently we had a session in New Haven, and it was me, Kaylee Roselle, Sholi, Kai Valor, and the engineer slash producer, Smokey Lavelle, and then there was another producer there, Dan. And I mean, it was like an entire vibe. It was an entire vibe. Like, we were there for hours, vibing.
Doing what you love.
Working. Like, the session ended up being longer than what I originally booked it for, but it was such a vibe that it didn't even matter. Like, we were going. And that was the record I was telling you about. But like, we were going in. But it's very rare that I get that experience.
Right.
You know what I mean? So nine times out of 10 though, I'd rather be by myself. But I'd rather be by myself more so when I'm creating. Like, when I got the beat and I'm just writing, I want to be in my own world, in my own zone, and do that myself. When I'm in the studio recording, like I said, I don't mind people there, but they have to bring value to the situation.
Right.
You can't just be there just to hang out.
You seem like an artist who likes to be in the moment. You take every moment and you cherish it. You put your all into it, but you're in that moment. So that's dope.
Yeah, you have to be. That's super important.
I say this, right? Not a lot of people know how to work by themselves. And like you said, you need like more creative geniuses around you, because it's only going to amplify your genius, and your art is going to amplify into a different whole level. Like you say, you sit there, listen to it, be like, damn, something's missing, you know? And that's a good thing that you just surround yourself around artists who are willing to help you out and give you artistic advice. Like, you know, I don't like how that sounds. Like, I think you should tweak it a little bit, or maybe you should write this instead of that, you know? Because us as artists, we write, but nobody's really proofreading.
Right.
You understand what I mean?
Nah, it's true. And like that session that I was saying from last week, the record is my record, and it's featuring all those other artists that I need. But like, Kai came in, and he, like, that was my first time ever meeting him either. He came in and took that session over, and he was like, "But like, honey, I know that this is your song, but yo, I got you. I think if you take this part and you just move it over here, and then Kay, come in and do these ad-libs in the background." Like, he basically is producing the record at this point. You know what I'm saying? So, but I didn't care. Like, he's like, "Yo, I hope you don't mind." I said, "Yo, I'm the type of person that I look at the big picture and the final outcome. My ego is not here. I don't got no pride when it comes to that shit. I look at what's going to be the best outcome for the record. I didn't sit here and pay however much I paid for the beat to have a mediocre track. Like, nah, I got a fire ass beat. I went to a specific producer to get this beat made. I got the beat made. I picked these specific people to be on the track with me because I felt they could bring something. So why would I sit there in the studio and not let them bring that to the table?
Exactly. How many producers you work with?
Right now, like here, I pretty much work with Shump a lot. No, his name is Chill Shump. I was saying I worked with Shump a lot.
Shout out.
Because he said Shump a lot. Yeah. That was
his name. I'm like, okay.
It
happens. Don't blame me. Please, don't blame me.
I work with Chill Shump. a lot. We're actually really close. Like, that's like my bro right there, for real, for real.
Nice.
I work with Shump a lot. I work with 2-4 a lot. It's been a little minute since I've done anything with 2-4, but that's who I work with a lot prior. And now recently, I've been going to New Haven a lot, and I've been working with Smokey Lavelle. So
Smokey, I know Smokey. That's my New Haven. I'm from New Haven. Shout out to Smokey.
I've been in this 203 area a lot lately. Yeah, I've been out here a lot lately.
That's right. That's a lot of time out here in CT. So
yeah.
Yo, that's what I'm saying. There's so many artists in CT, many great talent out here.
Yeah.
But they're not known. This is why YTFM Radio is here for, to give local artists a chance to be exposed.
A platform.
You know what I mean? How many CT artists have you worked with?
You know, truthfully, I really haven't worked with many. In the past, I had like a record with a singer from East Hartford, Isan. She's dope.
Nice.
I haven't really worked with too many, and it's not like for any real particular reason. Mm-hmm. It's just certain things don't pan out. Me and Elijah Richards, he's from Bridgeport. We had a record together a while back, and he's cool people. We actually been talking about working on something new together. But yeah, I mean, that was kind of like my goal for this 2020 was to, because I was like, I did my whole project in Atlanta. You know, the female that's singing on Got a Stunt, she's from Dallas. She was in Atlanta at the time when we were recording.
That's
so
nice.
It was like the writer who wrote that chorus, you know, he wrote it, he recorded the reference while I'm writing the verses. And then P was like, oh, I know a singer. Calls her up. She just happened to be in town from Dallas,
just
you know,
like that.
And you know, she popped over and recorded it. So, you know, that project was all out there.
Okay.
So now with stuff I'm doing now, it's like I said, like I got the record with Annoyed.
Mm-hmm.
We're actually shooting a video to that tomorrow.
What's the name of that song?
Mi Amor.
Mi Amor.
Shout out to Annoyed, man.
Shout out Annoyed.
Definitely.
And
then, you know, like I had hit Sholi up a while back. I'm like, bro, let's do a record together. So we went through a couple beats, and then I had got the beat made by Shump, and I was like, I think Sholi will sound fire on it. So I sent it to him. He was like, yo, this is the one, let's go. And then me and Kaylee, like I said, it's like we've been talking for a minute, and then, you know, now we're doing it. Chanel Sharp, me and her talked on Instagram a couple times about doing a record. So it's just really just putting it together with people, you know what I'm saying? And I really want to do a record with like Kato's. I had talked to Shump. We're supposed to be getting together next week, actually.
Okay.
Bugatti, I want to do a record with Bugatti. You know, I'm trying to move more into the other side of Connecticut too, because I really want to show that there's not that beef. There's been that weird thing of like, A6 over to 203, and I'm like,
stop. But yeah, you know, Connecticut needs to learn how to show each other love and support each other at all times.
Definitely.
You know, because we in this together. Imagine we between Massachusetts and New York.
Mm-hmm.
We're actually like monkey in the middle. We trying to get that star too. You know
but
what I mean?
Musically, who does Mass really got? Am I missing something?
Jordan Lucas. They got Jordan Lucas.
But
and he got a Grammy.
Jordan Lucas is fire. I am a fan of Jordan Lucas, but Jordan Lucas is not at that mainstream level like New York artists are. But then again, there's a lot of artists that came from New York. So
you know, but like I said, that's why Boston got a different feel to them and New York got a different feel. And Connecticut, we have
on Connecticut too much.
That's what it is.
What's our feel then? What's
sleep on Connecticut too much, and we get so lumped into that just period, like New York, New Jersey category.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? As far as when they meet a minority from Connecticut, because there's a stereotype that everybody from Connecticut is white. So,
like we from country, man. How we country?
We got the richest cities in the world, but that don't mean nothing.
I tell it like this, right? When I was in the military, I'm meeting people from all over the world, right? So, I'm at the club. I'm in Texas at the time. I'm at the club. I'm standing in line waiting for my drink. And dude come up to me, he's like, yo, you gotta be from New York. I didn't even talk yet, nothing. You gotta be from New York. I was like, no. He was like, New Jersey then. I said, no. He was like, so where you from then? I'm from Connecticut. He's like, oh, that's all the same shit. I was like, what made you just assume that's what I was from? He's like, the way you dress, your style. So it's like, we have all that encompassed together. It's just that people hear Connecticut, and they automatically assume We're just filled with white people. Don't get it twisted. Yeah. Obviously, we know we from here. It's a lot of white people. Mm-hmm. But when you go to the cities, it's all minorities. You go to New Britain, we are not the minorities. We are the majority there.
Exactly.
You go to Bridgeport, you go to New Haven.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Hartford,
the only time you see white people over there, that's because it's the capital, it's the business shit. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But when you actually go into Hartford, North End, South End, whichever way you go,
wherever,
you got Puerto Ricans and you got blacks.
All day.
You must see this too.
Yeah.
They're everywhere. Everywhere.
And people don't understand that about. And you know what? We're even ignorant to certain shit because I remember when I first went to college and somebody was like, I met another Puerto Rican. I was like, oh, where you from? I'm expecting this dude to say Hartford or something. He's like, from Willimantic. I'm like, Willimantic got Puerto Ricans? He's like, yeah, Willimantic got mad Puerto Ricans. But I didn't know. I didn't know it was like
a
large.
You found out.
I didn't know there was a large Puerto Rican community. You know what I'm saying? But we get ignorant. The shit, the same way people outside of our community get ignorant to shit.
Now, honey, when you perform, you know, whether it's local, in CT, or outside of CT, what is the audience, what is the crowd's, you know, appreciation of you? Like, what have you done where it's like, you know what, she's the one no matter where she's from. I'm that one.
When I perform, I show the fuck out. So it doesn't matter if I'm in Mass, it don't matter if I'm in Philly, it don't matter if I'm in New Britain, where I'm from, you know what I'm saying? It don't matter if I'm in Texas at South by Southwest.
Mm-hmm.
I've performed overseas. I've been in Japan. I've been in Europe.
What?
So for me, it does not matter where I'm at.
It ain't cheap.
But for me, it doesn't matter where I'm at. The stage is the stage, and I'm going to show the fuck out. And that's just how I feel. But I love performing. As an artist, performing is my favorite thing. So for me, when I start performing, I get lost in my performance. And
that's
I'm like
right.
a different person. So I go so hard when I perform that people gravitate towards me. And that's what you should do.
Right. Always.
When you really love something, you're supposed to give it your everything.
Right. I gotta ask this question. You, to me, are a pit bull. Where do you get this aggression, yes, yet sensual sexiness, yet I'm the shit type? Where do you get this from, like?
What?
Yo, honestly, that shit all just, I gotta say, it really does stem from the heart. Because when I was saying earlier, I was like, everybody now is picking up a mic and everybody now is mm-hmm. picking up a camera. Everybody mm-hmm. now is doing this and he doing that. But the real ones who have the longevity in their careers, it's because, you know, they're putting the art in artists. People aren't putting the art in artists anymore.
Not at all.
So the ones who have the longevity, because just because you hold a camera doesn't mean you could paint. I mean, doesn't mean you could really like portray the right picture mm-hmm. because you got a camera in your hand. You know what I'm saying? There's so much more to that. Real photographers, they love what they do and they have this certain eye that they can turn anything in this barbershop right now and they can make that shit into an epic ass photo yes. because they love it that much. You know what I mean? A videographer could put you in front of a brick wall who really loves what they do and nobody would even know you was in front of that brick wall because they freaked it so fucking much.
That's fact.
You know what I mean? As a hip hop artist, I always tell people, I'm like, I always go back to Jay-Z's verse on Renegade. Right?
Hmm.
Everybody always talks about Eminem kill Renegade.
What? You heard what she said?
No, but don't get it twisted. Eminem goes fucking bananas on Renegade.
I don't care.
What did Jay-Z say? Hold up. What did Jay-Z say? And babe, I might need your help because I've been drinking. What did he say? I had to hustle.
My back to the wall.
Ashy knuckles. Pockets filled with a lot of lint. Not a cent. Got a vent. A lot of innocent lives lost on the project bench.
What?
Bring dollars in.
Bring dollars in.
Come on, man.
Buy the bodega. I ain't under my shirt.
Feeling braver. Do bad. Wrapping my razor. Pockets full of hope.
What?
Yo.
Come on. And you telling me Eminem killed that? Come on.
Can you relate?
But who's saying that? People who don't understand Jay-Z's lyrics. Jay-Z painted such a vivid ass picture in those bars alone. But that's what a hip hop artist is supposed to do. And you take that
that's
back.
Right.
Go to MC Light. Go to Queen Latifah. Go to Little Kim when she was talking nasty as fuck. Because when Little Kim was talking nasty as fuck, guess what? Niggas' dicks was hard.
What? She could swallow a 2 liter?
Mine included. Mine included.
But that's what the artistry was.
That's true.
That's what it was. And I feel like I have an advantage on my end because that's what I was raised on.
That's right.
That's the hip hop that made me into an artist. Right.
Right. So what you think about music now and its format?
It's trash.
It's trash.
Why? Why the trash?
Because I don't even understand what the fuck half the shit they say is. Now, I'll put it this way. Think about when we was growing up, right? Mm. If you did anything besides smoke weed or drink alcohol, you were automatically a crackhead.
Right.
In today's music, crackheads are popular.
That's right.
Which is crazy.
That's true.
Which is crazy. Y'all are glorifying fucking 17-year-olds popping pills and shit. Like, what the fuck?
Drinking lean.
Like,
that shit fuck you all up, so.
That shit really will fuck you all the way up.
I must admit. This,
there are some new artists that I rock with.
They dope.
There are some new artists TJ. That I think are super dope. But for the majority, OG. I can't rock with it. Like, I'll listen to the radio just to, like, hear what's going on. But all that trappy shit, it's
would
like.
Would you get on the track with one of them?
I would do a track with Lil Baby. I think Lil Baby's fire.
And he's Sagittarius. And the baby.
The baby is another one that I think is dope. Meg Thee Stallion, even though that she's like a nasty girl and shit, I would do a nasty girl record with her because she's
my boo. I love you, baby.
But Meg Thee Stallion, I got respect for Meg Thee Stallion. I got a lot of respect for Meg Thee Stallion.
She dope, man.
I would do a record with Cardi. Cause Cardi's not on a new wave shit. Cardi just spits.
She spits her shit. Right. Yeah.
Whatever her situation is, it's just like
I definitely
Nicki Minaj.
I've never really been a real Nicki Minaj fan. I would do a record with her though. But Nicki Minaj's not a new school artist. But then again, I do got feelings about Nicki Minaj doing a record with Tekashi 6ix9ine because Tekashi 6ix9ine. You know what? You want to be a snitch, whatever you want to be, but he is literally making a fool of the hip hop game and the culture. And that is where my problem is. I really grew up on this culture. My dad was a DJ. My dad was spinning records when it was like Sugar Hill Gang. My dad was at parties spinning records when it was Diamond Girl, when it was Spring Love.
What?
You are hip hop.
My dad was spinning. Yo, I got in my dad's house right now. We got the crawl spaces. If I open them shits up, your mind would be blown at the vinyls that are in here right now.
Honey, why do you love hip hop? You are so passionate, man.
Yo, I grew up on that shit. Y'all gotta understand, it's only me and my older brother. My older brother is 9 years older than me. So I grew up going in his room where he's got a Fuji poster.
Ooh.
He's got a Bone Thugs and Harmony poster. You know what I'm saying? He's got Puff Daddy and Biggie posters and shit like that. So, obviously, because he's so much older than me, I was influenced on what I like based on what he liked. Mm. My cousin Fred is the one who put me on a Jay-Z. Jay-Z is my number one idol. Mm. When I think about things I want to do, I think about shit on a Jay-Z level.
Mm.
Let me tell y'all something, right? My second project that was supposed to have dropped back in April, we dropped the singles. And then it was supposed to be drop the single, build that momentum, drop the project. COVID hit and the project never dropped. So now COVID is opening shit back up. So it's like, okay, let's drop the project. I said, nah, we can't drop the project yet because the momentum that we built before is gone.
Yeah, that's right.
The project is an EP. EPs are short. Mm-hmm. It's only 7 records. Right. So we already dropped 3 records. What are we going to do? Drop another 3 to build momentum? That's the whole project.
Right.
So I was like, nah, we're going to freak it. And we're going to turn it into a visual project. Mm. So in the next couple weeks, because guess what? People want to level up and they talk all day. I'm going to be the next Jay-Z. I'm going to be the next 50 Cent. I'm going to be the next this. I'm going to be the next that. But y'all motherfuckers are scared to make those moves.
Make them news, yo. Make them
moves. Beyonce will drop a project right now and have a video for every motherfucking song on that project. That's and fair. Motherfuckers will buy it up. But you as an independent artist, you're too scared or you won't take that risk or you won't put the money up or you won't take that leap to do the same shit.
So honey, tell new up and coming artists what to do, how to go after it, Have their confidence. Talk that shit. Tell them what they should be doing.
You got to do what nobody else around you is willing to do.
That's it.
Point blank and period. Because simple. That's what's going to make you stand out. Look at all the greats. Look at how, look at Kobe Bryant's work ethic.
Rest in peace.
Look at what Michael Jordan was putting into the game.
Come on. Best legend.
And I'm a Michael Jordan fan all
hell
day.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Allen.
No disrespect to the LeBron fans and nothing like that, anybody else, but I'm an MJ fan. And that has to do with my brother. But whatever, I'm an
hell
MJ
yeah.
fan.
MJ
but man. What I say is, look at the Jay-Z's. And what's wrong with this generation right now, and what I hope that y'all will take out of this interview, y'all need to study. Y'all need to study. And when I say study, maybe you don't want to read a book. I don't give a shit. If you do want to read a book, read DJ Khaled, The Keys. It's mm-hmm. a great book. Read Russ's book. Mm-hmm. Read Rakim's book. These are all books that I've read. Mm-hmm. Read all you need to know about the music business, because that will teach you some shit. Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, also read The Artist's Way. Trust.
Yo, read The Artist's Way. Read from Indie to Empire. Like, trust me, I'm reading constantly. I'm on a new book every month. Read That's Deepak Chopra's 7 Spiritual Laws of Success. Because if you don't know what your real purpose is, you on the wrong path, point blank, and period.
So educate yourself.
You got to educate yourself. But when I say study, yo, if you look up to Meg Thee Stallion, for the females, maybe the males, whatever. If you look up to a Meg Thee Stallion, go on YouTube, type in Meg Thee Stallion interview. If you look up to Nipsey Hussle, type in Nipsey Hussle interview. If you're on Tidal, go on Tidal, type in, because guess what? Rap Radar, they done interviewed 1,000,001 people. Mm. Go watch Drink Champ interviews, because Drink Champ is interviewing too. All the OGs in the game. Mm. So you could learn the mistakes that they make, because they talk about all these different types of stories.
You
but you, if you really into your craft, you need to be watching 1 interview a day, at least. Even if it's a new school rapper or whatever. Yo, I was watching an interview a couple months ago. I was on the elliptical. Mm. I'm on the elliptical. I put on an interview by Lizzo for the Breakfast Club. So that's a whole hour interview. I did the elliptical for a whole hour. I'm watching her interview the whole time. I didn't even realize that Lizzo was signed for like 2-3 years before Truth Hurts even became popular. Signed to
that's
a record
crazy.
Label.
That's crazy.
Before her big ass single that put her on the fucking map is popping. That's but funny. You learn shit, and it teaches you shit, because people are so impatient and they want to have it now. Mm-hmm. You gotta read, you gotta watch, you gotta learn, you gotta take things in.
That's right. And one more thing you said you was in the elliptical. How serious are you about taking care of yourself and your body,
health wise?
I'm not gonna lie. Physically wise, I could be in the gym all day. Nutrition wise, I like to eat too much. So
I can relate.
Everything that I do kind of like falls to the wayside, because then I eat, you know, I'll be like, oh, I'm really in the mood for this. And I make it. Once I stick to my super strict diet, y'all ain't gonna tell me shit.
Right.
But
so
I do know that we need to be more conscious of what we put into our bodies.
Please do.
Because it is serious. And I do, even though I'm not like on a super, super duper strict ass, completely changed my lifestyle diet, I do, for the most part, watch what I eat.
Definitely, yeah.
I just have my days where I'm like, man, I really want a sundae with some caramel, right. Some M&M's, and some Snickers right. ice cream, and whatever. You know what I mean? But we all got those days.
Speaking of food, I like that. That question I asked you, Lou. What's your favorite food? Like, I'm trying to, it's a hot topic. Favorite food, favorite color, what's up? Let the people know what you like.
Favorite food, eggs.
Eggs? Why?
You know there's 100 ways to make eggs?
I love eggs.
Really?
I love my omelets. Yeah, I love my scrambled eggs, my fried eggs, eggs benedict. I just love eggs, my cheese eggs.
That's 5 of them.
I don't know the 100 ways. I'm going to have to Google that.
Got 5 ways at least.
Yeah, that's why the chefs wear that big white tall hat with like creases. It's 100 creases, because that's 100 ways to make an egg.
Yo, I love eggs. Like, my husband will tell you, I can eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Like,
all eggs. Eggs. I broke on eggs.
Yo, that's not a game. Okay. Rice and eggs?
Eggs are gross.
Y'all better stop playing, because rice and eggs is not a game.
Or scrambled?
No, with the yolk.
With the yolk, that's what I'm talking about.
This is fast.
This is a Puerto Rican, because he knows exactly how I feel.
Come on, man. Listen,
and you put the adobo in the yolk?
Come on, what? You heard that.
Garlic.
I'm gonna say shut your black ass up during this conversation.
Cut it.
Because
this nigga said garlic.
He trying
to kill vampires.
No, you can put my eggs, though. Trust me, I know
you
how to cook.
Garlic on eggs.
We'll talk about it later. Don't worry about it.
Yo, I swear. Listen, honey.
This is fast five with honey. So she says she likes eggs.
Oh, okay. Favorite color is purple.
Okay.
Purple is the color of royalty.
Favorite artist, male, female?
Jay-Z.
Okay.
All day, every day.
Favorite city to visit?
Favorite where?
City to visit.
LA.
Ooh. Okay.
I love New York so much, but there's something about LA, babe, right? Something about LA.
Yo, I say that, yo. Like, something about LA. See, I'm a night owl, so I be long in LA. Maybe I go to sleep early. I be up too late.
But in New York, though, everything stays open later That's than true. What they do in That's LA. True. But yo, I love Atlanta. There's a lot of places that I haven't been, but out of places that I have been, if you want to say favorite city, I gotta go with LA. As much as I love New York, LA is like a different. It's just a different vibe.
Favorite song.
Favorite song.
All time.
CC Peniston, finally.
What?
You heard it. I didn't think that one.
Nobody thought that my favorite song of all time is CC Peniston, finally.
Who's your favorite? Yeah.
I don't have one.
I got one.
I got my favorite.
Who your favorite?
My favorite is called The Definition. That's a track I did by myself.
Okay. Yo shit. My shit is Human Nature by Michael Jackson. I love that song. Okay. That shit is...
I'm lying.
I can't be mad at the Michael Jackson. My favorite Michael Jackson record is 30 Diana.
Yo, that's
my shit.
Represent Ogun. That's his favorite shit too.
Dirty Diana.
Yes. Listen to the lyrics. That shit. You're right.
Yo, that was inspired. But nah, a lot of people don't know, but CC Peniston, finally, that is my jam. Matter of fact, can you pull it up on the green screen? Can you do that?
I could do that.
Get your phone. No, pull it up.
Right now.
We're going to play it on the green screen. Yes.
We're going to do it raw.
This is not a green screen of mine. This is
like
actually a TV.
Too.
It's really a green
screen. Y'all like it too. Because that shit could be a guard. I wasn't expecting that.
Pull it up.
Number two is like More Money, More Problems. And shit like that. But number one, yo, y'all don't even understand. When I was 5 years old, my mom went from store to store finding a cassette single to this song. Wow. Like, y'all don't even understand. Cassette single.
Can y'all even spell that? You know how?
Y'all niggas can't even spell this thing. You sure? Y'all niggas is asking Google right now. How do you spell that?
You got that, Blue? I'm gonna connect right
now. Yeah, connect to the Philips NX5, man.
Got it.
Nah, I want this shit to be real dope with Holyfield. Y'all gotta play that shit right now.
Yo, we gonna play it too right here. Yes. So people, you gotta love it. Honey in the building. Honey, don't be upset.
Honey, question.
Talk
to me, I'll talk back.
Put that song
on. Before we put this song, looking for it. What's your next project? Who's gonna direct it? What's the next song? Who's featuring it? What the hell's going on right now?
I bet. You asked me six questions, you better have that song pulled up by the
let's
time.
Go, let's go, let's go.
I'm trying.
Nah, so I bet. Tomorrow, me and Annoyed are shooting a video to Me I'm On.
You and who?
Me and Annoyed.
I'm On.
That's my bro, for real.
Shout out to Annoyed.
Shout out.
He's a real one.
Let's get it. Let's
in 2 weeks, I'm shooting my short film visual project.
Wait, hold up. You a short film on some Michael Jackson shit?
Explain that.
Yo, so you know how I told you that, you know how I just told you, like, yo, we gotta launch the project in a different way. Mm-hmm. So, and I said, it was supposed to be, it started off with the idea as the EP is 7 tracks. So I said, let's do 7 1-minute projects, right? 7 1-minute videos to promote it for 1 minute of, and it don't gotta be the beginning minute, but just 1 minute of each song. So as I started coming up with the creative of it, I ended up coming up with six shorts and one of them making it a full video.
That's dope.
So y'all got a real surprising story. And then meanwhile while I am working on this Me Out More video and this visual project, I am already pretty much almost done with the next project that I will drop for y'all on my birthday, 12/21.
12/21. Shout out to that Sagittarius.
Shout out.
Yes.
12/21, y'all can expect a project called Universe. Before Universe, the project will be How You Living. So I'm leaving 2020 with a bang bang.
Boom. You hear that, right?
Bang bang.
Hey, Shabazz, you should have had that queued up already.
I got it. Cause honey got me. I'll play it right now for you.
You know how hard it was to find that with as much honey as in my system right now.
You seen her, right? You seen her.
I almost went to the lip video.
She's about to play her video. That was fun. I ain't even gonna lie, yo.
Like,
yo, my foot was happy feet all day. I'm telling you. Finally. Ooh. All I'm saying is, yo, honey, yo, you dope, man. Where you come up with these creative thoughts, man?
They just pop in my head.
They just rolling.
Okay.
You know what I really learned? And shout out to my nephew. He goes by So-So Baby.
So-So Baby. Shout out.
He been trying to find his way. And, you know, it's the same old story we was talking about earlier where your mom, your dad, they want you to go to college. I had that auntie talk with him, and I was like, look, if school's not for you, it's not for you, and it's not the end of the world. There's a lot of other avenues that you could go.
Not bad about it.
And he came to me, and he was like, yo, I really want to do music. I said, cool. He started showing me what he had. I was like, yo, you got some skills.
That's dope.
We got to create your sound. You know what I'm saying?
I see.
He's been on his own journey, making his own way, finding his own path and things like that. But, you know, like, with him and any other artist or whatever, it's just like at the end of the day, you got to just be true to you. And I told him the other day, we was on the phone, and I said, listen, I said, as long as what you're doing is coming from your heart.
Definitely.
And it's true art, that's you can't
real.
Lose.
That's real.
At all.
You can't lose.
That's real.
Because, yo, a real artist, like a real artist, painter, whatever, let's say it's a painter. They could paint the best masterpiece of their life and nobody ever buy it.
Mm. At all.
And what's the value of it?
At the time, nothing. Because right. Nobody wants to buy it. But it doesn't mean that it's not
worth
a beautiful right. piece of art exactly. and it's not worth something.
Right.
And so, that's why I said, as long as you truly believe in what you got going on for yourself, nothing else matters. Put your love and your heart behind it. Make everything art, whether it's, yo, I gotta turn this song into a visual. Make that shit art.
So, honey, I was gonna ask you, what would you tell to an up-and-coming artist who's into the music, who may be a little bit hesitant about pursuing it hard body? What would you tell them? What they should do right now?
I put it like this. I done left the music game more than once, but my heart always brought me back to it, because that's what really truly made me happy. If you are trying to become an artist and your music is what truly makes you happy, you have to fulfill that and you have to honor that. You have to go for that. If you're just trying to do that shit on like, yo, rappers get paid or singers get paid or whatever the case is, that's just not going to do nothing for your career. It's not going to do nothing for you. You have to absolutely and honestly and truly love what you do.
So you in this for the longevity?
Oh, I'm in it for the long haul. So. Yeah, this is me. This is so. At the end of the day, when people ask me who I am, like, I'm an artist. It doesn't matter if I'm going to school. It don't matter if I got a job. It don't matter if I'm fucking driving Uber. Mm-hmm. It don't matter what the fuck I'm doing at the end of the day to make a little extra dollars. Then I'm a motherfucking artist. Because can't nobody take away what I do with my music.
So what made you quit sometimes in your career? Like, you said that you quit.
I quit before because I kept running into the same situation of people supposed to be there and then leaving me.
Right.
And if they didn't leave me for this reason, they left me for the reason of I wasn't smashed.
Mm.
And as a female, we go through that a lot.
That's
where it's
true,
like,
I gotta go through
where
lot.
It's like, oh, you fine, you this, you that, and then they get you in a certain situation, like you gotta do this, that, and third, and when you really lay that down, like, yo,
I don't
go that way. Yeah. I don't do those type of things. You get cut off.
Mm. So it's really difficult being a female artist around male artists. So would you prefer working with female artists or male artists?
Nah, it's not a difficulty of being a female artist around male artists. It's a difficulty of just earning your respect.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I give y'all the example of what just happened with Megan Thee Stallion and Tory Lanez. Megan was trying to be a real bitch and not even speak on the shit.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't snitch out to the cops.
Say nothing.
None of that. Well, motherfuckers was really like, oh, she a liar, she this, mm-hmm. she that.
Mm-hmm.
To the point where she felt like she had to speak
out. She was compelled
No choice.
And say what really happened. And then she said what really happened and motherfuckers is out here labeling her as a snitch. Like, for females, it's so hard because we don't get the same respect that a man gets. Yo, a man could have spit the same lyrics that I spit, man-wise, you know what I'm saying? Like, and had a record, like a major deal already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, right.
I have to work on a whole nother level.
Yeah, you gotta, because they're looking for, like, beauty. So let's be honest. Sex sells.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things. That's one of the reasons a lot of women in the industry become famous, because they're beautiful and they can mold them into what they want.
Mm-hmm.
Understand? So
yep.
you being who you are, and I'm not saying that you ugly or any. I'm saying you're a beautiful woman in the industry, but they don't want to take notice just yet. But your music is speaking for itself.
You're
knocking down the doors.
Can't deny it.
Because, look at Cardi. She had to get her teeth fixed. You understand what I mean?
But also look at Rhapsody. Rhapsody might not be a Cardi, but Rhapsody been in the game for a very, very long time before she finally got that New York Times Square billboard. But I'm okay with that.
Right.
On my end, if that's what it takes for me to get my New York Times billboard, because at the end of the day, I can say I did my shit with dignity and integrity.
I mean, look at Deja Lo.
I like her too.
She a dope artist too.
I'm not a super fan of Deja Lo. I do like some of her records. Some of them I can leave them.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I feel like it's like, I mean, I love Jay-Z to death. Jay-Z is my number one.
You can't lose.
But there are some records from Jay-Z where I be like, I'm not feeling
anymore.
You know what I'm saying?
I say the same thing. I'm a Nas fan.
It's like that with everybody.
I'm a Nas fan.
I love Nas too.
But there's some tracks that Nas get on, I'm like, come on, man. And then there's some tracks I hear Jay-Z, I'm like, oh, yeah. Damn. And then vice versa, you know? It plays
both ways. And it's like that with everybody. And, you know, I tell everybody, I'm like, yo, at the end of the day, you can't please everybody. So you gotta
miserable
stop.
Miserable trying to.
You will exactly. You will go completely miserable trying to.
Trust me.
Yeah. That's why I say, And I tell this to everybody. You may not believe in God, let's say, but there is a higher power up there. Whether you right. call him God, whether you call him Allah, whether you call him Buddha, whatever you call him or her, whatever you decide to call that higher power, there is a higher power somewhere in everybody's universe. Mm-hmm. There's a higher power. And that higher power has a purpose for you in this life. You have to figure out that purpose. Now, I am a believer in God. So I feel like God has a purpose for me. Through all this quarantine situation and all this COVID situation, I have done a lot of soul searching. And in that time, I have sat there and I say, you know what? When I really go back to past experiences, things that I'm going through now, things that I want to do in the future, I say, you know what? Push come to shove, I really feel like my true purpose is to help people. Yeah. But what is my tool? My tool is my music.
Yeah, you know what? It's funny that you mentioned using music as a tool, because I heard the track when you say my name.
Yeah.
That track, I heard it, and that's like, yo, don't nobody really speak like this in the industry, you know? And if they do it for clout. Mm-hmm. And she really speaking from the heart. The fact that you included having your husband being...
I said my husband could have been Khalif, my son could have been Tamir. Cool. I could have been Brianna.
That's real.
So relevant. Like, that's so true.
And the fact that you went along and started giving light to the people that people tend to forget, because let's be real. Celebrities, everybody's talking about them. Everybody like, oh, the celebrity died. Oh my God, God bless their family.
It's trending right now.
And, you know, and rest in peace to these celebrities. Mm-hmm. And they will always be remembered, but these people won't be remembered. You understand? They will be forgotten and tossed to the side while the celebrities live on. You know, we know the struggle ourselves as minorities. We know what we have to deal with. Celebrities don't really have to, they have to deal with us trying to be like, hey, let me get your attention. You understand what I mean? They don't really have to deal with much. But like Nas' album, King's Disease, you do a little bit too much
that
of it.
That album is fire.
That's what I'm talking about. But yeah, you do shine some light on a lot of topics. And
with Say My Name, like Nas cut you off, but I really want to emphasize that with Say My Name, I really wanted to bring light to the women in the struggle, because so much is put on the black man's fight, and then not to take anything away from that, but there's a lot of minority women who have been killed the same way. Outside of Breonna Taylor and Sandra Bland, there's a lot of minority women that have been killed. Ayana was 7 years old, and I say it in the song. She was 7 years old when she got killed, a little black girl. And that officer, he got arrested and he got charged, but the jury deadlocked and he went home.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
See, that's the type of shit that they really gotta work on. Like,
it's not
a 7 year old girl by an officer. That's,
y'all gotta really understand something, that when people talk about like, oh, we're going to protest and we're going to defund the police and we want this and we want that. Y'all got to really understand, yeah, the police ain't innocent with how they look at black people, Spanish people versus white people or whatever the case is. But it's the entire system that is fucked up. I had this conversation with my husband the other day, because I said, yo, our government is based off of a piece of paper that was written off of fucking slave owners who was raping their motherfucking slaves, who had kids with their slaves. And they wrote the Constitution that is what this government till this day is fucking living off of. Nothing is gonna change until y'all burn the fucking White House down, until Washington, D.C. is burned down. But then here lies the problem of that. Once you burn the motherfucking White House down, who the fuck do you get to take charge? Because Washington, D.C. is ran by a whole shitload of pedophiles, clearly.
Yes.
I'm not even a conspiracy theorist, but when all the facts keep coming up, that's niggas is selling their soul to the devil, and that price ain't cheap.
So I see you really intellectual with a lot of things.
Passionate, too.
Like, yeah.
Oh, I do my research.
You research a lot, and so... have you researched ways to, like, invest in certain like helping the community out in your area?
One thing that I have done for my community is that I found out about a child in my community who was suffering from cancer. His mother was unable to work because of all the doctor's appointments and things like that that she had to do with her son. So I did throw them a fundraiser.
That's what's up.
And that's where that shit count. I didn't do that on no clout shit, nothing like that. I did that because I genuinely saw a family who was in need. And I was like, yo, people aren't doing something. Something needs to get done. Like, more things need to get done for people that are in need. So many people will look at your situation and feel bad.
Right. That's it.
But why just feel bad?
Right, right.
Let's do something. You know how easy it was for me to get people on board for that fundraiser?
Yeah, tell me how that went.
So, the little boy, babe, how old was Angel at the time when I did the fundraiser? Was he three?
Yeah, 3 or 4,
it
was 3.
I think Angel was like 3 years old. He had cancer and he had already been fighting it for over a year. So when I talked to his mom about everything, I hit up somebody that I knew who ran one of the kids' basketball leagues in New Britain, and I said, can we use your gym? He said, not a problem. Hit up my graphic designer. I said, do you mind donating a flyer for this project? Not a problem, Nick. Cool. He did the flyer for it. Couple local restaurants. I had them donate the food.
That's dope.
My dad's cousin actually has his own like bounce house business. So he was like, I could donate the bounce house. The only thing I can't donate is the rate that I have to pay my staff. So if you could just pay them their $40, like, you good. That's so cool. I was like, all right, cool. That's not much. And then I had a bunch of local businesses come. And everybody who came and set up a table had to donate a percentage of their profit, whatever they chose. Right. They had to donate a percentage of their profit to the pot that was going to the family. And then for the people who couldn't make it, we had a GoFundMe going. So we ended up raising $2,500 for the family that day.
Yo, shout out to him, man. Hey, I respect that. You took action. And the fact that people respect you is golden. Because you just made calls and everything just fell in line.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when it comes to a sick child, if you can't say, yeah, I'm going to donate my time or my resources to that, you're just a fucked up individual. Point blank, period. Because I legit, everybody once I was like, yo, this little boy's only 3 years old and he's fighting cancer. They were like, what do you need? Everybody's there. I did have one person, though, that didn't want to donate their time. And I was like, that's cool. I hung up the phone with her. I was like, that's cool.
Did you look at them at a different light after? Like,
everybody has their own priorities.
Definitely.
You know what I'm saying? True. I don't know what her situation was. Maybe she's a single parent and was like, yo, I can't afford to just donate my time.
You think the worst?
I don't know. You know what I'm saying? So I try to give everybody the benefit of the doubt because at the end of the day, there's a lot of people. Yo, point blank, case in point. Chadwick Boseman, he shot Black Panther while having cancer. Like,
that's crazy, yeah.
People didn't even know he was making movies and having cancer.
Yeah,
that was.
I thought it was for a movie scene. Like, I know he was getting slimmer, but I thought it was for a movie. I didn't know it was health wise.
And people didn't even know that he'd been battling cancer for the last 4 years. So it's like, you know, you never know what people's situation is. So I'm very big on like just giving people the benefit of the doubt. Now, if I give you the benefit of the doubt and you fuck me over, it is what it is. Right. But I still am like a real firm believer in just like not automatically assuming the worst out of everybody.
That's right. That's right. So, you know, not to change the topic, but do you prefer heels or sneakers?
Sneakers.
Your Jordans.
I mean, to be honest, when I heard your song for the first time, I ain't see the visual yet. She sounded a lot taller. I'm telling you, she sounded like she was about my height. I'm 5'10".
6'7", 8".
Nah, that's... My boy said she was Jordan height. Yo, but meeting you in person, you're a lot smaller than I really thought you were.
4'11". Shout out to all the shorties out there.
You know? Shout out to the shorties. Look, it's the great time for me to say, what up, shorty?
What up, dwarf?
Yeah.
Hold on, that's politically incorrect. That is offensive.
I know.
You hear that? Shabazz.
I'm not considered a dwarf.
No. Of course not. You too. No. She's not a dwarf, y'all.
Hey. Please follow Honey on YouTube.
Yes.
Y'all can find me everywhere at Honey Music. H-U-N-N-I Music. Even on YouTube. My YouTube channel is Honey, but if you type in Honey Music, it's going to come up.
H-U-N-N-I.
Instagram, Twitter.
What's your next? All that shit. What's going on right now?
I literally have 4 projects getting shot within the next 40 days.
That's not bad.
So, she works. I don't exactly know which one is going to drop first. Just know that there's a lot coming. Know that there's the project, How You Living, is going to drop. There's a visual, How You Living project that's going to drop. There's the video with me and Annoy that's going to drop. There's the video with me, Sholi, Kai Valor, and Katie Roselle that's going to drop. And then there's a whole project that's going to drop on 2021.
Let's get it. Y'all can be ready
for that.
I'm ready for that.
I'm ready right now.
I'm not even going to tell y'all the name of it yet.
Ooh. You gotta wait.
All I'm saying, it's a great pleasure having you.
Yes, honey.
Hey.
Y'all going to see me a lot more because these boys like me so much, they about to make me the third co-host.
Yes, let's get it.
Yes.
I like that.
Hallelujah.
And to be honest, I really felt this was your show. Yeah, I just laid back and let you do she took the wheel lights.
The wheel. Feel me? You were.
I just put my seatbelt on.
I can't help it that I do my tuck tism.
Hey, I ain't mad at that, man. Anybody you want to shout out?
My husband, my kids.
Yes. Family first.
What up?
Can you come in the camera for a second?
Come on, Q.
Come on, Q.
He's
taking the wave right now.
Was that my phone?
Yo, my boy Q in the building. Yes.
Look, I think your head is cut off.
Nah, head is perfect. He good. And this is YTFN Radio. I'm your host, Blue, the Bill Luciano, and that's
T. Taurus Shabazz.
And this is Honey.
Hey!
We coming to y'all live and direct.
I appreciate having both of y'all, man. Yes, y'all are great. We about to kill it the next time. You're going to see her more. For sure. Peace. Hey, need a haircut? Come to 805 Hartford Road, Manchester, Connecticut. Look for iCuts. Nobody cuts like iCuts.
We mean nobody.
Never gets old.
Never.